VIP. He says she's so sweet, make her wanna lick the rapper.
Lick, 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 lick me like a lollipop, lollipop. Welcome back to fucking Candyland. I have missed our weekly therapy sessions in fucking Candyland. And I feel like going a couple months, taking a break is a beautiful thing when you're doing it. But then now that we're back, I'm so glad to be back. I missed you so much.
I miss you. And it always cracks me up when I hear you cuss. Because you put so much emphasis on it. And so it's not like just fucking Candyland. It is fucking Candyland.
Like, you know what the vibe is. It's been a while and the energy has been transformational this summer. I feel like this has been one of the most transformational summers of my whole life. What about you? I feel like you've had a lot of breakthrough moments. And also, like, everyone, Gemini wasn't as TikTok famous as she is now. Now that we're back, she's over 100K popping her shit in her moo-moo part 26, part 32. What's up?
Part 26, part 32. No, dude, this summer has been so fucking cool, but I feel also just for like figuring just different pieces of ourselves and figuring out who we are right now. You and I have both just had these like just random experiences with like friendships and relationships and just so many different things that have been transformational moments, things that I don't think either of us, you know, there are personal things that we don't want to talk about on the podcast, but I have to tell you about that trip that I took to Vegas with my husband. Because I never even told you about it. I was just like, oh, we'll wait till we come back on the podcast. And then it's been like 2 weeks.
She doesn't tell me anything anymore. She's like, we'll save it for the podcast. And then I'll be honest, I wasn't feeling good. So I wanted to cancel one time we were going to record. And then another time she needed to change it or something. So like, you know, we're really flexible about that stuff. But then like a whole 9 days will go by and we'll be like, damn, we never talked about that. We never recorded. What's up? How are you? I miss you.
Well, I feel like we check in about things that are big things. We're like, yo, girl, this is what's going on right now. Like, can you pull a card for me? What the fuck is happening in my life? But when it's like the day-to-day regular things, I feel like we do wait for the podcast stuff. And a big part of that too is I feel like we've really come to a balance, you and I, with the stuff that we're comfortable publicly sharing and the stuff that we really want to keep private and to ourselves. And we do use the podcast as a way to connect with other people on certain topics that we are willing to discuss. And I feel like that's why we don't talk about it behind the scenes, because we process it firsthand with, like, I feel like our little group of people. I say little group, but we have literally thousands of listeners.
You know, I miss the podcast because I do feel like it's a way to really gauge your growth. It's like a liquid journal, you know? It's like you can just go back to an era and be like, what was I doing in December 2022 or whatever? And just kind of like see that growth and see that transformation. And I remember that in the beginning of the podcast, we were like really centered on like making sure we had topics and that we like really had a good description going and stuff. And like, we'll be honest, now we forget what we've talked about and our descriptions have like went not as specific, because it'll be like 2 weeks later and we'll go to post it and you'll be like, what do we talk about? And I don't remember at all what we talked about. And so like, I can just tell a difference of like when you first start something and you like want it to be perfect and you want it to be this and you want it to be that, but you have to just let it be whatever it is. And I think that's what we've learned, like, especially just like with the audio and the video of like recording at your house and recording across the country. You know, a lot of people can't even make this shit work in person. So like making it work across the country, across time zones, you know, we've said it before, like those are the obstacles that people don't realize that you have to overcome when you're going to like start a project with someone or just start a project in general. And I think that, you know, of course there was that surge of like podcast and content during the pandemic, but like that's slowed down. And now the people who kept pushing at full speed are popping their shit in the top tens or the top, you know, three podcasts of the world or whatever. Like, of course, you know, consistency is going to be key, but how engaged you are with your audience is the important thing. Because something that's happened this summer that we haven't talked about that I can't wait to speak on, all of these like TikTok celebrities like Sexy Red and just whoever and whatever going and trying to make big tours, even Justin Timberlake making this big stadium tour, this big arena tour, trying to be like Jelly Roll, but they're not in their prime. Like, y'all are out. Like, the prime, it was not there. I mean, maybe for JT back in the day, but like, come on, brother. Like, you know, go play some amphitheaters and just like, you know, sell your little 5,000 tickets and move on. Like, you don't get to sell 40,000 tickets or 30,000 tickets. I mean, I just don't know, like, 30,000 people that want to go pay $400 tickets to hear Sexy back. You know, if it's the whole, if it was NSYNC, sign me up. Let's go. I would be all in. You know what I mean? But like these big celebrities and like how the numbers, people have been buying numbers, the bots, the fake followers, the fake engagement, the ranking of like how much you're going to pay Instagram based on what they show you as being popular or cool. And I think it's just so funny how many people are like having to cancel these tours and like are getting canceled in a way. And like, I had heard this rumor because, you know, JT got caught with like drugs and then got a DUI, which said that he had to go to rehab. And they said that it was fake because with those big tours, when you book them in the policies, there's like an insurance clause that protects the venue, meaning that if you don't sell a certain amount of tickets, they're going to fine you that additional money so that they get their overhead, like, and they break, you know, whatever threshold they need to break. And so it was basically saying that like he wanted to cash in on the insurance clause, which would be that he had like a bodily injury or something happened to him detrimental to his health or well-being that could like claim insurance on those fees because he had to cancel the whole tour. So like
there, something about him too is that at the same time that happened is when people were really popping off because of Britney's book. And you know, something that sticks out to me is, you know, we're always talking about like having grace for people's healing journey, right? And like things, you know, different versions of people from the past and whatnot. And the thing that I look for inside of somebody's journey and to see if they're working on like a healing and growth journey is to see if they're able to take accountability from things for their past. And that whole situation, you know, and obviously we're looking from the outside into Justin's life, right? Like we don't know his day to day, but when all that stuff was going on and he's being canceled and slammed and people aren't showing up to his concerts and whatever, not one time did I see a statement come out from him where he's like, I was a teenager inside of Hollywood. I was famous. I didn't know how to deal with that. I absolutely put this on this woman. She had, you know, a miscarriage. I didn't help with any of these things or, you know, whatever it may be, taking accountability for old versions of yourself and then being like, I'm married now. I've learned things. I would do things differently. I have learned how to better adjust, you know, whatever. And I think that that's something that people are really looking for. And you wouldn't, you know, I don't believe in cancel culture, but I do believe in taking accountability for things that come out about you, or at least addressing it. You know, it very well, like he could have been like, that's not my perspective of it, but that's her perspective. And I'm so sorry that I ever made her feel that way. And people would have more understanding than all of a sudden this weird ass shit happens with you having drugs in your car and your venues are canceled and now you need to go to rehab or whatever. But up until this point, you and your wife have been flaunting on social media like your life is perfect and everything's fine. So it just like the lack of accountability for me happens with a lot of people. I don't really know the other artists that you mentioned. Like, I don't know who Sexy Red is. But it makes me think of Marlboro cigarettes.
Yes, you do know who that is.
Do I?
I don't even want to know who that is, and I'm forced to know who that is.
Who is it? Is there like a song I would know?
I'll have to play it for you. This is
Okay.
her sexy red clip. We won't get copyright infringement, but we will. I'll play you one. I
Okay.
personally don't. I think it's almost like one of those situations, like it's a social experiment, like with her, like she's not really like famous. She's like an industry plant, as they would call it, like where they plant celebrities that just kind of make a mockery or a fuckery of themselves. And she's kind of does that in a way, like kind of like that Ice Spice Girl, like the stuff they talk about and the things they say and like the way they act. It's like a train wreck, kind of. I don't
Why
know.
don't I know who Ice Spice is either? But like, am I in a bubble? I don't know who any of these fucking people are.
I don't want to know who they are,
If
but
you're not Jelly Roll, I don't fucking know you. No, I'm just kidding.
I really don't know, but I was forced to know. I thought you definitely would know who that is because of TikTok, though. But I guess you're on the other side, a totally different.
I'm so specific with my fucking algorithms on TikTok. I'm so specific of the type. Like, I really like educational things on TikTok, and I like things that make me laugh. It's very rare that I find new music or that I find like influencers, if you will, on TikTok. I like to have a protected bubble over there because the second that you step out of where the light touches, it's all fuckery and bullshit, and I don't want anything to do with it. And so I feel like we've talked about how happy I am with the block button, but I literally, that block button, you could just fucking post that you burnt your toast this morning, and I'll be like, this is the kind of negativity I don't need in my life, and I'll block you.
You know what's funny is like one time y'all Bunny texted me and she was like, XYZ, look at this person. They're fucking weird. Like they're saying weird shit to me. They said a bunch of weird stuff to me. I don't like it. They sent me their stuff. Well, of course, like I didn't know who they were because like I don't get on TikTok for real anymore and hardly ever look at really anything on there. So, anyways, when I sent it to Gemini, Gemini goes, hold up, I have them blocked. And like literally, she had this person blocked. And I didn't know how more symbolic that could be that this was a weird ass bitch that we needed to do a little return to sender and make sure this bitch was, in her own world, living her own prophecies. But she was definitely in like a meth psychosis, the lady was. And like whenever I said that to Bunny, Bunny was like, well, she's supposed to be sober, but she definitely used to do meth. And I was like, there you go. Because I don't know who she is at all. But I just thought it was so funny that Gemini had this lady blocked. And so, like, the universe is weird like that. I think sometimes, like, I just don't resonate with stuff and like just completely won't even get onto it like for months on end. I did that with Facebook for years. I didn't have a Facebook for years, I tell you. And now
I tell you a story if you sit down and listen to it.
tell you.
Okay, I gotta tell you about Vegas. So, first of all, I knew that you had to walk places. What I didn't fucking know is that walking across the street takes you an hour and a half, and it takes you an hour and a half because you're having to. So we stayed at the Flamingo. And which is like right across the street from like Caesar's Palace and like right near the Bellagio and shit like that. So you have to walk across like sky bridges. You're having to take escalators to get up to an overhead pathway to take you into a hotel for you to walk 17 miles through cigarette infested machines so that you can walk out to go walk through a restaurant, to go downstairs, to go walk back across the street, across another escalator. Like, it was a whole fucking mission. And so when we first got there, it was extremely overwhelming. Like right when we got to the airport, there was a whole lot of people, traffic in Vegas, like people driving in Vegas. You guys are fucking cunts. Like You guys driving, like, they're barely, the roads are barely marked. Lanes are barely marked. It's all fucking faded because everybody and their fucking grandmother is driving there all the time. I imagine it's hard for them to redraw the lines. People do not use their blinker. They just like it was a really wild experience getting the 4 miles from the airport to the hotel.
In an
But
Uber?
no, my father-in-law picked us up. Starting out this trip, we get on the plane, we rode Spirit. Never again will I ride Spirit Airlines. We were stuck on the tarmac for 5 hours. It is a 1 hour flight, by the way, people. And Spirit is so federally, there's this law that you can't be on a plane for more than 2 or 3 hours without them offering you water and snacks. Well, we're on this plane. There's kids, there's babies. We're stuck on this tarmac. And finally, when it's time to go and we're up in the air, this lady was like, "Can I please get like a water? I have a kid here, whatever. We've been here for all these hours. You guys didn't offer us refreshments." And the man goes, "Well, we pulled back up to the terminal and we opened our door. So technically, our time restarts and we don't need to give you anything for free." And it was just a really like it was a really wild experience. But we made it to Vegas. It was overwhelming that first day, just all of the people. But Brian and I went out, we explored, saw Caesar's Palace, which I thought was really beautiful. And so that was fucking cool. I didn't get as many pictures as I wanted. Like I imagined I'd be doing tons of content and pictures, but like you're really living in the moment there. And also people. And like I don't know. I just was like, I felt so on guard while we were there. So first night we get there, it's whatever, we do our own thing. And then the next day is my father-in-law's wedding. My father-in-law chose to get married on the rooftop in Vegas at 10 a.m. in August in the desert. It was hot as balls. My husband looked fine as fuck though. And so I was sitting there and I was just like, damn, like, can we wrap up what we're doing? Like, I want to go hang out, do my own thing. As we were there though, what was really interesting to me was I felt this like, I'm trying to figure out how to word it, but I almost felt like people who are raised and grow up in that environment, I feel like they have to have this like crazy fight response to everything. Because while you're in Vegas, the energy is very much everybody wants something from you. When you're walking, people are trying to stop you so that they can sell you something. They're trying to invite you down to the pools. They're trying to offer you drugs. They're trying to get you to go in and spend money here or there. They are like stopping you inside of your space and people bump into you, they don't apologize. And it was really weird because we went into Ross. Brian forgot shoes for the wedding. So we went into Ross and he had just like told the girl, like, hope your day gets better, because there was a rude lady in front of us. Hope your day gets better. Like, have a wonderful night. And her reaction was like, she thought that it was rude that he was telling her to have a better day and like to have a good night. Like it was almost like she was taken off guard that she wasn't being treated like shit. And it was just a completely different culture. And it was super triggering for me. Like it just made me think of like any icky energy that I've ever been in and like feeling like I have to be on guard all of the time. I wouldn't want to go there without my husband. And I'm very much like, not a person that like I feel like I need like my man to be around me or whatever, but I just felt like you have to have another set of eyes on you and not be by yourself because it just feels like unsafe.
I have so many things to say about Sin City, Las Vegas. But I have went to Vegas by myself before and had a literal blast. I love Vegas. We're going to Vegas in a couple months again.
Gross.
I love Vegas. I don't know why I love Vegas so much. I don't love the cigarette smoke, but I like all the lights and I like all the like people watching. And honestly, I didn't really like, we always rent a car, so we don't like walk anywhere, like doing all that thing. I mean, I have done Vegas like that, but then I've learned that getting a rental car is so much better, and going out like to like other places in the city and going thrifting and going like, you know, just like there's so many things that are like off the strip, you know. So
yeah,
I always recommend to people, like when you go to Vegas, don't go there for just like the nightlife, but like rent a car, drive to the fucking Grand Canyon. It's a couple hours. You can drive to Joshua Tree in a couple hours, except you're going to be in the middle of a scary desert if you do that. But you know, there's just different places that you can drive and like see. And like, you know, I just think that it's a really beautiful place. I like the desert itself, but I would never go in the summer. I only go like in like November or like late fall, or like, you know what I mean? Like I'm are not really trying to go in the peak of summer, but I have went in August before. It is hot. I've been in May before. It was hot. Like I've been a lot, but I like New Year's Eve is fun there. I went New Year's Eve one time and it was amazing. And then, you know, I think it's all about what you do when you're there, like the shows and the different stuff that I've done. It's been like a cool experience. I've seen Chris Angel a few times, but yes, people are weird. You do have to watch people, but I just be watching people. I don't know. Like I have like a radar for it and I just feel like I feel fine there, but people are definitely gonna try to take advantage of people they think that they can take advantage of. For sure. That's why, like, I wouldn't recommend getting really drunk, or that's how they fuck you over, is because you start getting drunk, you start getting fucked up, then you start pulling money out the bank because it feels fun. All of a sudden, this feels so fun. You're like, oh my God, I have $800 in the bank. I'm just going to pull 500 out.
And then yeah. It definitely wasn't a negative experience. Like, it was, but I think that the thing that I liked most was just having time like away from our life and like our kids and just like getting time by ourselves. But if I could choose places to go to do that, Vegas wouldn't be one of them. Like I don't, and I think a big part is like, I don't like spending money unnecessarily. Like gambling to me, like it's fun to go and play. We played roulette. That was like what we played a lot. And we did a horse race thing. And so like, those two things are fun. Cool. I could do literally anything else to blow money except hope and pray that there's a 50% chance that I get my fucking money back. Like, that's not fun to me. I'm anxious. I have to shit myself because if I lose this money, like, I'm just going to be fucking annoyed. I don't like drinking and I don't like drunk people. So, and I don't like cigarettes. So having to go down where y'all are drinking and smoking, like, that is not my fucking vibe. But I loved the lights. I loved when we got off the strip and we, because my father-in-law got married there and his wife's family was there. So we, and they have, I don't know what her parents did, but they had a nice house in Vegas with like a big pool in the back and stuff like that. And when you went into their house, it literally reminded me of just like mob homes. It had like for rugs and shit like that. And it just like, I don't know. The house has definitely made me feel like mob mafia vibes. And that's probably because of all of the videos, like all of the movies that have taken place, like in fucking Vegas and casinos and stuff like that. So I thought that part was cool. But we also drove through a lot of areas that were like I've driven through neighborhoods and stuff where you could tell like, they didn't have a lot of money and there was like a lot of poverty in the neighborhoods, but I've never seen so many houses in such a long area where it was like, you know, those people don't have food. You know that they probably don't have power half the time. The place is like, you know, crumbling down. You have kids' bikes outside and stuff. So, you know, kids are living in those environments and whatnot. So there was just so much different. I didn't prepare my energy. And I think that's really what it comes down to, is because I had never been there. I didn't know what to experience. I don't feel like I was energetically prepared for the amount of people, of different circumstances that you're going to come into, and of needing to like have my guard up and feeling that way.
You didn't take the term Sin City to heart.
Well, I wasn't going to get a fucking hooker, right? So like, I didn't know.
Sin City didn't do it for you, whenever they were like, yeah, you know, but I think people do go to Vegas and sell their soul. They go there and lose their life savings. They go there and lose their retirement, their family's savings, their grandfather's estate, you know, like whatever. Like, you know, that's the one thing that I don't like about gambling is because I have people in my family that are kind of like avid gamblers if they have access to funds. And even if they don't, they would spend like, you know, their last $50 and get like half with food and half on some lottery tickets type deal. You know what I mean? And like, you know, no worries about it at all. But I think gambling for me is like, I'm willing to, like, if I'm willing to like lose $200. Normally, if I just say, like, I'm going to gamble with this $200. And if I win, I win. And if I lose, I lose. If I have that type of attitude, I'll normally win because I'm not attached. But the moment that I'm like, I have to have this $200, I won't even want to gamble it because at that point I'm attached to it and you're kind of blocking it coming in. So anytime I've won, and I have won, one time I put $20, my last, I had $50 and I split it with someone. I gave someone 25 and I took 25 and I was going to spend 20 gambling and just keep the five, right? Like, you don't want to spend all your money, right? I put 20 in a slot and I pulled it and it hit for $1,250. And obviously, like, that has never happened again, but it is a memory that is a core memory of, like, you know, pay the lady. So anyways, we ended up taking that money and splitting it and actually winning a lot of money. Like, I left with like $2,000 that night, and I had $25 to my name at the point. So, you know, sometimes I think that gambling can be fun and there is that adrenaline rush. But if I'm not willing to part with the money, there's no point in me gambling it. I do a lot better when people give me money to gamble with
Oh,
when
yeah,
I'm
I'll do
not attached.
anything with your
Yeah,
money.
because then I'm not attached at all and I'll win. I, like, literally, like, I'm a very good lucky charm when it's someone else's money. But with that being said, you know, I feel like if I'm in Vegas, I like give myself like $200 for that. Or a lot of times I'll just do like 100 here, 100 there. Like, I'm not gonna do 200 at once or whatever. But normally, like, I'll win some, or if I don't, like, I'm not tripping, but I have won like on some slots in Vegas and stuff too. But like, it is one in just like 1 millionth for you to walk up and hit something on a slot. Like, you know, a lot of times you've got to be sitting there for an extended amount of time. And then in a gambler's brain, they truly believe, like, well, I fed it all this money, so it's gonna hit. And then it like just keeps taking the money.
We won some money playing roulette, and we ended up going to this restaurant, and we did like a breadboard, and we did this like seafood tower, and it was so fucking good. It was so much fun. I don't think that it's not fun to like go and gamble and like have a good time, and I sound like I'm just fucking like complaining and like a stick in the mud, which I'm not. I just If we hadn't been going there for his wedding and had like this family experience there, I feel like I would have really wished that we had gone somewhere different. And I think that there's so many triggers that I had for just, and that's really what it comes down to, is I think that people can go and have an amazing time. For me, I just felt a lot of triggers about things because I've worked really hard to remove myself from energies where I feel like people just want to like take advantage of something, or where I feel like I always have to be on guard, or like I have a really hard time with like mass amounts of people, or again, people drinking around me. Like those are just triggers for me. So I went to a space where that's what it's all about. And I went in there knowing that's what it would be about. But sometimes you don't realize the impact that things are going to be on until you're there. And something that I kept thinking about while we were there too is like, I'm seeing these like gross rich dudes fucking walking around places or whatever. And I'm thinking about like, there are girls here in this city who literally have to touch your fucking wiener for $100 because they need to fucking eat tonight. And you look fucking greasy as shit and you're just sitting there fucking smoking those cigarettes. But I know you have money and I know you're gonna pay for someone to come and touch it. And like, so it was like, it was just a fucking thing. And then I was thinking about like, damn, Bunny was raised here and she's had like, you know, these experiences being out here. Like, how scary that must be that like you have to go with somebody up to their hotel room and like that's your survival thing is like you have to do this and this is a position that like you're putting yourself into because you have to survive. And I just like I had so many emotions and things. It was a whole thing.
You was in there channeling them spirits.
It literally felt like I was having this like spiritual experience there that I was like half down for and half scared of.
Okay, so Vegas and Nevada has like different microorganisms. I don't know how many, but there's like over 10 that only exist in Nevada, like in the world. And then, like, you know, like Area 51 is in Nevada. So, like, I think Nevada has a lot of secrets and a lot of spiritual stuff. And they put like Vegas there as like a distraction. It's kind of just look over here. It's bright. It's shiny. Come get fucked up. Come have a good time. And you'll just never even think about the rest of the desert. You know how many people I know who have been to Vegas like a handful of times and have never seen the Grand Canyon? And I've been to Vegas probably like 7 times. And I've been the Grand Canyon at least 3 of those times. This most recent time I took my dad out there because like my dad had never been. And now like
You
my
took your
dad,
dad to Vegas.
because we have the same birthday. So yeah, we went out there for our birthday. And
People think your dad's fine.
who's seen my dad?
You've posted your dad before.
Who said that? You posted your dad before.
You've posted your dad before, and I don't remember who said it, but I remember there was like, no, there were text messages with people talking about how your dad was hot. And I can't remember if it came to us in a group or just to me privately, but there were at least two people. I remember getting at least two text messages about one of them. I didn't know Paige was dating somebody, or I didn't know you were dating somebody. And then there was another one. And yeah.
No. Wait, what? What? Oh my God. This is news, but the craziest thing about my dad is one time
This is news.
in high school, I was hanging out with this girl and her mom and her came to pick me up at my house. And like my dad was like a helicopter dad. So he would always want to go out and like meet the parent and like talk about everything or whatever. And whenever he walked outside, this lady hopped out of her car, jumped, wrapped her arms around his neck, and wrapped her legs around his waist. And this was
No.
my friend's mom. And at the time, I was like, what the literal fuck is going on? But come to find out, they had dated like back in their yonder years, and yeah, we're having a whole moment. And so yeah, my dad has been a
Imagine seeing somebody that like you dated back in the fucking day and just being like, I'm gonna run up to you and I'm just gonna throw my body on your body. I don't know your marital status. I don't know what the fuck. I don't know if you have herpes now. Like, I don't know what's going on with you, but I'm about to just put on your bones.
literally. Yeah, that's exactly what happened. I don't know. Yeah.
Wild. My stepdad, we went, when I was in high school, and we went to church. It was my mom, my stepdad, and I. And one of the ladies in Sunday school was like, "Are you going to introduce me to your little friend?" And I was like, "That's my dad." And she got so mad because she thought that we were fucking with her. And so my mom had to be like, "No, like that's my husband. Like, what the fuck?" And I'm over here just like, I could have dry heaved. Like, don't ever accuse me of being with my father.
Wow. Well, that's what you just said, that someone texted you in a text.
Yeah, that's fine. I mean, it's not my dad, so they can say whatever they want about your
Girl, no.
dad.
So, my
You're so caught off guard. She can't even adjust right now. She's just like, what? Who would say that? I wish that I could
Wow.
tell you who it was too, and it wasn't any time recently. I feel like you
I know.
guys,
I posted my dad like a year ago. Once.
that's when it was, because I remember you guys went out and you grabbed food or something like that, and you got complimented. Dude, I know too much about your life. I feel like you got complimented on your jacket or something like that. You're wearing a jean jacket.
You're so cute. You're so cute. Why is she so cute? Look, we haven't been doing the podcast and we've been missing all the details. What were you gonna say? You said you had to tell me something.
Fuck if I know. I told you about Vegas. I don't know. When's the last time we talked? There's so much shit to catch up on.
I know it really feels like we took forever off the podcast. I guess it's been about 3 months, and that's definitely a long time. A lot happens in 3 months. And I feel like I've went through so many changes just this year. I feel like 2024 has been a hard year. Like it has been a hard year. And when you think that COVID was 4 years ago, that's fucking wild talk. Like, that's so
Yeah.
wild. And like, I feel like there's just so much that has happened. And even for the worse, I feel like things have gotten worse. Like, when they could have gotten better, there was a chance for them to get better and they got worse. And I think that so many people were trying to get in tune with themselves. And the reason that things got worse is because people still need to dedicate that time and not go out to the bars, not go to the places that, remember when they were closed, we couldn't go to them, and like having to sit with yourself and having to sit in your own energy, like that stuff is difficult. And I think that's like important as like going and being triggered and going to places that trigger us and learning things about our triggers. Like knowing damn well, like you said, I would never go there without my husband, so like never going on a girls trip there because we go there. Juver's got
I'm not going on a girls trip to Vegas. I tell you that right now. And it doesn't have anything to do with like, it's not that I felt like physically unsafe when we were there. Like that's not, it was all just like the emotional aspects of it. And like, it was so nice when we would like go back to the hotel room and I could just be like, these are all of the things that like I felt and experienced emotionally, mentally while we were out there walking around, or like, when, we're in the casino and that dude like bumped into me, and I can tell you that like he has his wife and kids at home and they don't know that he's on this trip right now. And you know what I mean? Like just all of these different like fucking things, dude.
Damn, she was reading him like filth. She was like,
I could not turn
why
off
are
the
you
psychic
cheating on your
abilities.
wife? She was like, damn, dirty, but that's crazy.
That's what I'm saying. That's why I'm like that. That's why I'm like it was just so like I could not turn down the like there was no protecting my energy from any of the messages and things coming through. So like I see greasy old dude over there and I'm like, you're about to go and try to find like the youngest hooker that you can get yourself. And it was just a little bit too much.
Yeah, I mean, it's crazy. I feel like I used to really be like in tune with like a lot of random energies in the past. Like when I first was in my spiritual journey, like so loudly. I don't know. Like I remember that and like I don't know. I just kind of like turned that off because I don't want that. Like I do not.
I mean, on the regular, it's like able to happen, but like
No,
I don't have that issue except there, dude, and I was just
it's
so
true.
uncomfortable.
Vegas can be intense. And honestly, like, I've been to Vegas and, like, sometimes people are fucking weird and you kind of just gotta, like, check people like, on the street or wherever. Like, I don't know. People are just hard on their luck out there, too. You know what I mean? Like, it is a weird environment. Like, I can agree with that, though. But I personally, when I go out there, I don't really have, like, a care in the world. I don't know why. I just be loving it out there. I have no allergies. I'm just out here, damn, water bottle, big water bottle.
Hell yeah, I like to be fucking hydrated.
I know, but you're like, I'll never have to,
This bitch can hold like a gallon of water.
I see. She's going on a hike. It's her juggie. Says
It's
juggie.
called a juggie.
I see it. It's nice.
Oh.
It says juggie
Oh, it does.
on
I was
the
like,
front of it.
damn, you're so smart. It's a juggie.
She's so funny. Yeah, I think that the juggie is a good addition. Everyone needs to drink more water.
And it has these cute little like buttons that you can get that like can come off. So I've got like a coffin, obviously. I'm just like all types of stuff.
Wow. Wow. It's like a pair of Crocs, but it's a juggie.
You remember those bracelets that they used to have, those that had like the little metal squares on them, like the charm bracelets, and you used to pinch the fuck out of yourself just to get that thing on and off?
Yeah. I actually had a bunch of those. You know, I've always loved stickers and collected stickers, and I have like all the 50 cent stickers from like the machines, like the old ones and like the homie ones and all kinds of different ones.
The homie.
Yeah, I have like so many different stickers. And then like at that time, my mom's best friend owned a grocery store, so they had those machines. So they would get like the demo packs of like what would be in there, and I would get like the whole pack of like what was going to be in the machine. So at that time, I was really up on stickers. Like City Girls was up on the stickers, and I have all of them because I was like an anxiety ridden child who didn't want to stick them anywhere, because I did stick them. You know, like over the years, stick them and stuff, and then you would like lose them. You know what I mean? So, like, it's funny the ones that I still have. I have quite a few, like, a lot. I love it. And
I
it
don't think there's anything that I'm trying to think if there was anything that I had like collected, but I don't really think so. Although I did, my parents were cleaning out my old bedroom at their house and they found this pencil box. I had this like little best friend and I dated her older brother for a while. And she used to write me, we used to write each other letters back and forth and like the most like elaborate written out letters. And so I had this like huge pencil box of just like written out letters from her that I didn't even know that I had kept. And I was reading through them and I'm like, I don't remember a single fucking one of these things. And she's talking about like, oh my God, it was so much fun sneaking out and like going here and going there. Like, can't wait for you to stay the night at the house again. I'm like, I don't remember sneaking out with you. I don't remember doing any of this shit.
Damn. I used to write letters to people. I used to have a shoebox full of letters. I have like I don't think I have those, but I have like, you know, yearbooks and different things and like a lot of keepsakes. But like the moment that I got my own place, my dad just literally loaded up everything that was like that he had at his house. So I have like a collection of VHSs, like original, like old style Disney and just different VHSs. I have the VCR too. And then I have like all the hardback Dr. Seuss books, which are worth quite a bit of money. I think all of mine are first edition. I have all first edition Harry Potter hardback books. So I have like a lot of like just like stuff like that. I actually have a Barbie suitcase that's hot pink that's full of Barbies that are just like beat the shit. Like I don't even know what's in the Barbie case, but I have a lot of stuff from my childhood. Just random stuff that like I don't really know what to do with it, but I don't want to get rid of it. It's just kind of like, you know, I have it.
Nostalgia.
Yeah, I have it in tow. It's like maybe one day I'll display all my VHS. I'll display my something. I don't know. Watch them. I'm not sure. I know some of those are worth a lot of money.
Watch, there's going to be a mandala effect that VHS has never even existed and that it's all a figment of everybody's imagination.
And then I'm gonna have a whole box of them, like.
Yeah, but it's kind of like how they say that like the Fruit of the Loom label didn't used to be what it is, like the cornucopia or whatever. And then there's also movies that they're like those don't exist, but people have the VHS. But when you go and Google it, it'll be like this movie never existed. This actor says that they never did that movie, and you're like, no, legitimately, like I'm holding the VHS of Sinbad right now.
Yes, Sinbad. I knew you were gonna say that. You know, I really feel like I saw that movie as a kid. Like I saw the movie. Like it is a movie. So I get it. I understand
Well,
it.
it's like how they say movie quotes are changed. Like everybody has the same movie quote, and then they'll be like, no, it was said this way and not this way. And like, I'm sorry, but entire four generations of people are not remembering the quote from Mary Poppins the wrong fucking way.
And Forrest Gump, they say that it was always life is like a box of chocolates or something
Yeah, life is like a box of chocolates. You never know what you're gonna get.
yeah, you never know what you're gonna get. Yeah. And they say it's different than that.
Yeah, well, I don't believe that at all, and I think Tom Hanks is in on it.
I think that they like feed us movies and different things for a reason. They set precedents through like movies and like the concepts they teach you, whether they teach you like this is the perfect family or this is right, this is wrong, this is good, this is bad, this is scary, whatever it is. Like, and I just think that like people absorb these timelines and absorb so much stuff that like manifests because of like collective thought, collective focus, collective emphasis. And I like for the last probably, I don't know, like 10 years of my life, if something's super popular, like at that time, I just will not pay attention to it. Like when
Fact.
it was like, Game of Thrones, everyone was like, you should watch it. Still, I've never watched it. Sons of Anarchy, watched like maybe one episode. That's it. Like never watched it. Like just different things that were
Shut your fucking mouth.
super popular. Not that I wouldn't watch it. It was just like when it was popular. Like same thing with Breaking Bad. When Breaking Bad was super popular, I didn't want to watch it, but then I watched it on my own time and enjoyed it very much. You see what I'm saying? It's not that I won't
Enjoyed it.
It's just that when it's popular, I'm like, y'all can have that. I don't want to be in the collective conversation about it. Does that make sense?
No, totally. I'm the same way about those things. Also, Sons of Anarchy, worth watching. But I've never seen Game of Thrones. Breaking Bad, I never watched when it was popular. It was afterwards. So very much similar with you. But I also think that that has to do with the fact that we don't want to have our emotions and reality taken away because of what the mass people are doing, which is like, when everybody was having the COVID hysteria and whatever, you and I were both like, we're not fucking taking your shot. Like, you know what I mean? Like, we're not, that's not something that we're doing. We're not bringing that into our reality, whatever. And that's one of those things too. Like, even the COVID thing, like, I feel like the same way that you're talking about them doing that with movies, that was its own test and its own, like, what can we get society, to do? And something that is happening here locally in one of our local towns is that they're trying to close down bars and not have and make it so that people can't go in and like buy alcohol anymore and like it, go into these bars. And which takes away like a huge like economic revenue locally and stuff like that. And so they noticed that during COVID, like there's not really anything that you're going to be able to do about it other than what, like sue the fucking city. Okay, cool. And so when everybody gets into these like hysterias, and this is my personal thing, but I think that anytime that you get into trying to take away other people's rights because they don't align with what you like and what you think should happen, you set the precedent that if something isn't agreed on, everybody can just come together, agree that they don't want to do that, and overthrow other people and silence people's voices. And I've the older that I get, and the more that people are talking about politics and are talking about different things, the more that I notice that it's a very like, well, those people are evil because they believe these things and want this, and they want to have these rights. Let's shut those down. But these are the ones that we stand for. And if they try to come at us, then like they're evil, awful people. And it's just, you can't ever win. Somebody always is going to try and take away something that you have, you know what I mean? Like, you're gonna not have health care over here, you're not gonna have guns over here. Like, it just, instead of it being a culture of like everybody's a fucking adult and like you shouldn't have to have Big Daddy in the White House to tell you what the fuck is right and wrong or how to do things ethically and morally because you're a fucking adult.
Yeah, I think that they really need to bring ethics and morals and like those types of conversations and like classes back to the masses. Like they used to teach people like home ec and, teach people like life skills and, wood shop and different things. And I just feel like they're dooming the children by dumbing them down and giving them iPads and giving them no books and like teaching them that a screen is all that they'll need. And, they can use a fucking calculator later now, so they're not even learning math at all. Like, we were not allowed to use a fucking calculator just because it existed We were also brainwashed at that time to be told that you wouldn't be able to use one in the future, even though that's a bullshit, bold-faced lie. And, you know, but the thing is like a lot of people have no life skills. They're not being taught life skills at home, and they're definitely not being taught or nurtured at school. But yet, you know, tax dollars are funding the schools, even if you don't have kids. That's the one thing that irks me the most about, like, not having children, is because, like, you're funding the public schools in these big cities, because I live in a big city regardless. So it's like, you know, we are getting no say. You know, at least if you have a child in the school, I guess you could join like the PTA, or you could join something, an advocate for your child and their needs or whatever, right? But like, you know, I just think the system's so fucked up. Like, it makes little to no sense on the way that they do things. And, you know, like, even just emergency services, like healthcare services and ambulance services, and, you know, people needing to have rides to doctor's appointments and assistance to appointments and things like that. Like, there's so many hoops that these people have to jump through, or like so many things that they have to go through that, like, a lot of people couldn't even fathom or really understand. And, you know, I think the system just heavily focuses on everything outside of the home, and it really does start like within the home, because if you're not being taught morals and values, and you know, you're not growing in your home, and a lot of children are not, and a lot of people are not, it can be detrimental to everything.
Yeah, I recently had this conversation with somebody because I got a post on one of my videos. I was eating McDonald's or something, and they commented about like where McDonald's like spent, you know, spends their money or whatever they support. And so I got into this conversation with somebody where I'm like, I am an American who has to pay taxes on, and my money gets spent on things that I don't fucking agree with. You know what I mean? Like, regardless of where we're putting our money, it is supporting somebody, spending that money on something that we don't have an agreement with. And literally, like, down to the toilet paper that you buy and everything else, like, those companies allocate their funds to all types of things you may not believe in. You know, Chick-fil-A spends money on shit that I don't believe in, but I love me a chicken sandwich. So, like, it's so unrealistic to boycott things and shame. And it's like the culture of shaming other people because they're doing something that you don't feel like aligns with you, instead of like minding your own fucking business. Also too, like, this will be a thought process that people don't fucking like, but instead of spending all of this money to organize petitioning for the government to put funds where you think the government should put funds, and spending thousands of dollars to organize these things, you could literally put that thousands of dollars towards the thing you're asking the government to pay for, since you're going to spend money anyways.
Yes. Yes.
Thank you.
Think there is a lot that is backwards. I think a lot of people have gotten into like the GoFundMe culture, thinking that like, oh, you know, I want to go to college, people can help donate, or I want to do this, people can help donate. And I mean, I guess, but I think sometimes like those should only be used in certain circumstances. I know we've talked about that in the past, like certain health circumstances and sudden death and wrongful death circumstances. But like, I've seen people start a GoFundMe because they want a boob job, because they want a BBL, you know what I mean? Like, there's been all kinds of things that I've seen, you know, and obviously this was not someone I personally knew. It was just something, a viral thing, but people don't want to grind towards their goals and dreams as much as other people. And the other people that do are paying both. They're paying both.
Well, it's kind of like how there's the expectation of like, if you do well in life and you bust your ass and you end up being wealthy or having, you know, a multitude of abundance that's more than somebody else inside of your space, there's the entitlement that, well, you have it and I don't have it and we're friends, or, you know, you're my aunt or whatever. So like, you should share some of that with me. Oh, she's just, you know, they're selfish because they live in this beautiful home and they go on these trips or whatever, and they're not helping us with the whatever. It's the, it's, there's always an expectation that the things that are important to somebody else or what their needs are should be what's important to you and what you care about.
I think money brings out true colors in people. And I like literally do not subject to like some of the concepts that I've been taught about money and like taught about things. Mm-hmm. And especially like being raised by people who like to gamble and like to party, like to drink, you know, like not a great combination. Money, I think, brings out, you know, it brings out good and bad. I think that's why, you know, some people donate a lot of their money. Some people live beyond their means so they can donate and help others and do whatever. Some people don't care about other people. You know, I think there should be a level playing ground that's got to like give to the point of like, just because I work harder doesn't mean I should have to do all this extra. I think there should be more like real resources for the people who need it and less resources for people who are taking advantage of the systems. And, you know, I think that a lot of those funds and things like that should be allocated towards veterans and, you know, people who have served our country and helped, you know, gave their life really, you know, or even like my grandpa got drafted and against his will had to go to Vietnam War so everyone else can sip on milkshakes and chill, you know, like the summer before prom, I might add. So anyways, you know, like he was like 16. So I don't know. I mean, I think that this whole system's fucked up because that's fucked up, you know, and they actually.
I know people inside of real everyday life who are completely capable of working, go out, have a job, absolutely no fucking reason that they're incapable of it. And they would prefer to have welfare and have people pay into them. And because they've, you know, worked a couple jobs or whatever before, like, oh, I've paid into it. So like, I just deserve to sit back and like collect this money and whatever. And like, these systems are set in place to help people who need help. And I feel like people take advantage of temporary help and try to make it permanent because it seems like it's so much easier for you to sit back and not have to do anything. And whether you're on GoFundMes or you're applying for, you know, state welfare and things like that. Eventually, I just believe that these things that we're pointing out and whatever, people who are keeping themselves in small, limited energies are going to recoup that in a bunch of different areas of their life, whether we can see that or not. They're going to have less opportunities for things. They're going to meet less people and be surrounded by other energies that are not interested in growing. And they're never going to actually meet like their full potential that they could inside of this space because they continuously put themselves in spaces to lower their vibration. And just to specify, I'm not saying there's anything wrong with needing help or needing to be on welfare or utilize, you know, any resources that people have available to them, because that's a real thing. But people who live their life to take advantage of others and to take advantage of systems and whatever they can and nickel and dime their way through, those people will always stay in lower vibrational things. Thank you for coming to my TED Talk. You know exactly who the fuck I'm talking about. And thank you.
You know, and honestly, I've seen people who have a lot of potential still want to stay like under the radar and like not rise to the occasion on things. Mm-hmm. And like, you know, I think sometimes people are just comfortable in what they're familiar with. They're comfortable with like how the lifestyle that they're living or like how they live, even though they know they need certain things. They need to change certain things. They need to do certain things. Like, and if you need to do those certain things, you would think that in your brain, you're like, okay, well, I'm going to work towards making that happen. I'm going to work towards making that happen instead of just like, no, I'm just going to kick my feet up and say I need those things and say that it'd be nice if I had those things. Other people have those things. Like, I should have those things. Like, that entitlement, you know what I mean? And that's what I see, like, from a lot of energy is it like turns into that entitlement of like, you know, they have it, so I should have it too. And I think that's where the off balance is in the collective. But, you know, it sucks to see someone that you care about have more potential than they're wanting to like utilize, or someone that you care about that you know is capable of doing certain things, but is like not going to, or not wanting to, or not emotionally available to, you know, like I think so many different levels of that, like people can resonate with, whether, you know, it's a family member, a partner, someone, especially like our parents. You know, I think a lot of times, like, we have like deeper trauma than we're willing to admit with our parents, especially if our parents are still active in our life and still like alive and kicking and like in our world and in our reality. Sometimes it's hard to admit that, like, that we do have active trauma and that we are triggered by certain emotions or things, or certain feelings and concepts bring out negative emotion. My cat is being bad. But, you know, I think sometimes our emotional attachments is what really keeps us in those stagnant cycles and keeps us activating that time and time again.
I agree. And I think too that, you know, emotional attachments to things also, people will say things, people that we're close to or that we, you know, have some type of an emotional connection with, sometimes say things in the space of jealousy, being jealous that they don't have things that they see you having, or mindsets that you're having, or whatever. Recently, there was somebody who has been in our life for a few years, and they have to be a space in our life. And they're like, oh, well, you know, I know where you guys came from. And like, it's great that you guys are doing well now. But like, you know, I remember when you guys were down and out. And so like, if I'm needing money or I'm needing something, like, you guys should give that to me because you've been in the place that I'm in. And it like sparked like a huge conversation with my husband and I, because, you know, your emotions get hit, right? Because somebody who wants to take advantage of something and wants something from you, people are very good at manipulating emotional energy and making themselves a victim in something and making you feel guilty for having more, doing more, achieving more. And it's so much, I don't think that people necessarily do it on purpose, but it's such a prevalent thing. And we had to really analyze and be like, do we want to give this person money or like help them with things? No, we've worked our fucking ass off to be where we are right now. And that's why we're in this position where, you know, you would come to us and ask these things. You don't put in any of the work. And so there's a difference between like you being a compassionate person and helping people around you who are like putting in the work and trying, and you just can't get a step ahead, because we've all been there. We've all needed help. We will all need help again at some point with something. But that gauge of like, is this person doing everything that they can inside of their universe, inside of, you know, what's in their control to try and better themselves? Or are they just sitting back and being complacent in life and then blaming people around them for doing well?
Yeah, or becoming bitter if they're not blaming, yeah, like internally. Like, I think some people just internally embody that, like, that like I'm a loser, or like, you know, my life sucks energy, and like they embody that. And it's not even that they're like comparing or jealous or upset about other people's life. It's just like, this is my life, and like, mm-hmm, it's just what it is kind of thing, you know what I mean? And like,
yeah,
I don't know, a lot of people, I feel like I get into that stagnant energy, and sometimes like a relationship will send you into that spiral, or a breakup, or a heartache, or, you know, losing someone, losing a spouse, losing a friend, losing somebody, you know, different things send us into depressions and triggers. And I think sometimes people get into those cycles and it's just like, well, my life is just, every time I get excited about something, this happens, or every time this happens, it goes bad. Or, you know, just having that mindset is attracting that. And like, always having that reminder that we try to remind people is like, you know, is easy as it is to dwell and like worry, it is the worst thing to do for your outcome. And we are all guilty of it. Like I like recently went through something and I was just like in fear. And like at the same time, like knew it was going to be okay, but still was in like a fearful mindset. And I think that at every corner, if you're leading with fear, like expect fear, like expect things to fear then, you know, because you're kind of attracting that. And, you know, we have to lean into like our truth more than what other people are showing us, because everything is subject to change. Like there really is no concept of constant when dealing with other people's emotions or even our own emotion, because from day to day, we always are wanting something different. Or there may be like one underlying thing that you want, but at the end of the day, like you become and change your perception of that as time goes on, you know, because some things are just not meant to receive right at that moment.
I think that's big too, being able to see things that you know you're going to receive, but understanding that it's just not meant for this timeline right this moment, and that you have to be patient for however that ends up unfolding for you.
Think this is perfect too. Leave the conversation because, you know, sometimes we do have to trust the divine timing of things.
Yeah. Well, it was nice being back.
Yay, I know, I loved it. I love it here. And we will see you next time in Candyland.
Bye.
Bye.
It's obvious we're goddesses, full of the divine femininity. Who need masculine energy, energy, energy?